Okay, good morning everybody. It is a great pleasure to welcome you for attending the workshop analysis and numerics of design, control and inverse problems. Let me introduce myself. I am Giuseppe Floridia. I organized this workshop with Enrique Zuazua. My thanks to Enrique for the great support, and also to Dallas of the FAU staff in Erlangen for the support for the web page of this workshop. I would thank the IDAM Institute, in particular the President Professor Giorgio Patrizio, the Vice President Professor Giovanna Moscariello, all the scientific committee of the IDAM, and all the very nice staff of the IDAM Institute, Dr. Mauro Pedrucci, Dr. Elisabetta Esposito, Dottoressa D'Alfonso, Dottor Feliciangeli, Signor Galati, and all the people that support this event also at the Globus Hotel. Let me introduce the aim of this workshop. As suggested by the title, the workshop will cover several topics of applied mathematics, and in particular control and stabilization of PDEs, shape optimization, best problems for PDEs, numerical analysis of control problem. Before finishing, let me just add that we plan to publish a volume with the IDAM Springer series, collecting original high quality contribution by the speakers of this event. It is a great pleasure to start to introduce the first speaker. Before Enrique, you would add some words about this organization?
Well, so I would like to thank the IDAM for the opportunity. That's first. This workshop would not have been possible without the support of the IDAM. And for us, it's of course an honor to be able to cooperate in the IDAM strategy and planning of this academic year. The workshop was planned for last year, actually, right? So then we postponed it because of COVID. And then we know that this workshop is coming simultaneously with many other activities. We understand that for many of you it's quite difficult to be with us during the whole week, but we hope that the program is interesting enough to keep your attention while possible, so that you can come in and out. There is a very strong echo, Giuseppe. I think I better don't say anything because there is a very strong echo.
Unfortunately, yes.
Also, when you speak, there is an echo.
Yeah, I change the... Sorry, I asked to the staff. Thank you.
C'è sempre qualcosa perché devi mutare, cioè, tutti quelli che in sala hanno, ma se non si mutano, viene
certo, certo.
Aspetta un attimo, può funzionare.
Ok, now is it okay?
Now it sounds better, yeah.
Okay, let us start with the first sphere. Okay, it is my pleasure to introduce the first speaker of this workshop, Professor Pierre-Marco Cannassa from the University of Roma Tor Vergata. Professor Pierre-Marco Cannassa is well known to all, already twice vice president of this institute, Indam Institute, and now is president of the Italian Mathematics Society, Unione Matematica Italiana, UMI. Okay, start.
Okay. So let me start by welcoming all of you and thanking you for being here. So my first thanks also go to the organizers of this shop, of this workshop, Giuseppe and Enrique. This is probably the first workshop, Indam workshop, at least of the post-pandemic era. So it's a special time, and we should be aware of that. And as all the premiere, it will somehow fix some standards for the future, right? Many people attending the workshop and some groups in presence. So it, of course, we hope it will be for the best in the future. So anyways, since we have already spent some time in the organization, let me go straight to the subject of my talk, which has to do with control theory, in particular bilinear control, for a class of abstract evolution equations. And this I will report on some joint works with Fatia Alabo Gussuria and Cristina Urbani. Okay, so. Con questo no, è questo che prego. Okay, so let me start by introducing the problem and some motivations. So in control theory, usually one considers acting on a certain physical, chemical, or biological system, whatever, by an exterior force. But sometimes this action is not realistic and is not possible to implement. Think of the large energy that would imply influencing a complex system like the weather on a planet, or a nuclear reaction. So it is better to try to control the evolution by changing some of the parameters entering the system and letting the system itself do the job. So this happens in elasticity with so-called smart alloys that may change the response of a beam to the several forces acting on it. Or in chemistry, where chemical reaction may be altered by the addition of a certain substances, catalysts, and so on. Another example of bilinear control happens in nuclear reactions, where you have a fission phenomena. And then a very simple model for such physical situation is given by a parabolic equation like this, where U represents the neutron density involved in the reaction, and V the neutron amount in the surrounding medium. So you may hope that by controlling the amount of neutrons surrounding your medium, the reaction can be controlled, shifting from a nuclear bomb to a nuclear power plant. So mathematically, this translates. So mathematically, this translates into, well, for example, considering an evolution equation in a Hilbert space, for example, driven by some operators A and B. For the time being, let's suppose they are linear operators, and with an external force P, which is a scalar function, multiplying one of the two terms. So this is an example, very easy example, where I try to control an infinite dimensional system, U is in Hilbert space, by a single input control, P of T. So I cannot hope to do whatever I want. Let's see what we can do with this model. There are other examples of bilinear control, and I will mention them shortly. Example of the situation I have in mind occur with, for example, the Schrödinger equation, where the amplitude of the electric field can be used to control the evolution of the wave function. Another example I have in mind is the so-called Fokker-Planck equation, which describes, which is related to stochastic processes, for example, and to the evolution, in fact, of the law of a solution of a stochastic diffusion process solution of a stochastic differential equation. If you start from even one-dimensional stochastic diffusion process, where B is the drift and W is a standard Wiener process, and you look at the density of the random variable X of T, which is the measure, the density is the function that allows you to compute probability related to this random variable, then the density turns out to be solution of a parabolic equation of this form, which is exactly the Fokker-Planck equation. And you may want to control the evolution of this density by using, for example, the coefficient B. And in this talk, we will in fact apply our results to this model, taking for B a function with separated variables, and our control will be the time component. Okay, what are the difficulties of bilinear control as opposed to additive control? So this is an example of additive control, and this is the bilinear control case. So in additive control, you just add an exterior force through an operator. In bilinear control, you multiply your solution itself by the control. So it's a nonlinear problem. The response to the first system is linear in the input. So you input P, and the solution depends in an affine way on P. In the second case, the response is nonlinear. In the first case, you have a closed formula for the solution. In the second case, you can only hope for a fixed point, for an existing theorem. Okay. In fact, I mean, due to this weaker, more complex dynamics, well, the typical result you would expect for many control problems is out of reach in this case. Due to a celebrated theorem back in the 80s by Ball, Marsden, and Slemrock, that states that in the infinite dimensional case, if your control operator B is bounded, then the family of states you can obtain from an initial condition U naught by letting your control action range in L1. Is very small as a dense complement, is the countable union of compact sets. So you cannot hope to go from U naught to some set with non-empty interior, for example. It's, so, okay. Okay, some references on the problem. The result by Ball, Marsden, and Slemrod that I have already mentioned. Then there are many results on bilinear control, but I'm just mentioning those that are mostly related with the model I have in mind, so single input controls. So there is this paper by Bouchard and Laurent, where they study the Schrödinger equation with this kind of control. And then Bouchard, again, she studied the wave equation, essentially in one space dimension with the techniques of implicit function in local inversion theorems. If you let your control depend on time and space, then you have a wider possibility of attacking problems. And some many results are related to the work of Kapalov, where approximate controllability for large classes of data is obtained by controls depending on time and space. And also I mentioned this paper with Giuseppe and Kapalov. So other results which are directly related to this talk, and I will not refer to explicitly all the time, is this paper with Fatia and Cristina, and this on stabilizability of this model, also with Cristina again for the degenerate parabolic equation, and paper on controllability by Bouchard and Marbach, which is probably the closest one to the result I will speak about today. The paper by Bouchard and Marbach is on one-dimensional heat equation, so a specific PDE in one space dimension with possibly nonlinear dependence on space and control. And then this paper, again, with the idea. So let me start with addressing stabilizability issues. And then we move to controllability. So for stabilizability, of course, one can introduce several notions. You want to steer initial conditions close to a given one U bar in infinite time by the action of P. So you can have a local stabilizability, exponential stabilizability, and super exponential stabilizability. Exponential stabilizability is what you would expect. Decay occurs at an exponential rate, and super exponential at e to the minus e rate. Okay, so consider the picture where A is an unbounded operator, densely defined, self-adjoint, accretive, with compact domain, a very specific situation when you can find where you can find an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors, and of course the related eigenvalues go to plus infinity. And we will address the problem of stabilizing the solution of this system to the solution of the uncontrolled system, starting from the first eigenvector, for example. This is called the ground state of the system. The solution is this, and well, in general, if you do nothing, the system is already stable in the assumption we posed, and so you have exponential decay. But in fact, if you do something with your control, one can show that you can have better, much more efficient decays. The result, the typical result, I'm giving a full picture, but this theorem can be decomposed in several bits, and I will comment on that later. Suppose your operator A satisfies, so basically two assumptions. A satisfies what is called the gap condition, namely the eigenvalues are separated. They do not get close to each other when k goes to plus infinity in this sense. And B satisfies a sort of spreading property. So B spreads the first eigenvector, the first eigenfunction, in all directions. If I take B phi 1, this color product is non-zero for all k's. So for example, a constant operator identity would not be good, would be very bad. So I suppose that B does just exactly the opposite of what a constant operator would do. The identity operator would spread phi 1 in all directions. And moreover, a certain convergence technical assumption, once you have that this is different from zero, that there exists some exponential decay that makes this series converge. Okay, so under these assumptions, you can locally stabilize your system to the solution of the uncontrolled, to psi 1, which is the solution of your system with zero control and the ground state as initial condition at a super exponential rate. So you have, there are constants, positive constants, m and omega, such that in fact, you can have an exponential to the minus e to the omega t rate convergence. And in fact, you can, introducing this rho, you can also fix the acceleration of this convergence. Okay, so this is the result. Let me briefly give you an idea of the proof. The proof is is constructive, and essentially is based on a Newton type argument. So this is the system I want to control, and this is the solution I want to control you to, the uncontrolled system. So let us look at the difference between the solution of the first and the second one. And let's assume for the time being that the first eigenvalue is zero. So that in fact the solution psi is time independent. It stays, is constant equal to phi one. This is a special case. Then if I take the difference, I compute the difference solves this problem. The initial condition is the difference of the initial condition, and I see this additive term pop in the picture. Now I have fixed capital T greater than the constant tau that occurred in the hypothesis for the convergence of the series. This is the equation I want to stabilize to zero, and I look at the linear version, the linearized problem, which means I take out this term, and I'm left with the first, second, and fourth term here. The idea is I control the second equation to zero, and I use the same control to steer the solution of the first equation to a final point, which will be not zero, but hopefully close to zero. So this is what I do. I take a V-bar, the solution of the linear problem. I control it to zero. I find the P, and this is I will explain how we do it. I find a control that drags me to zero for this system, and that is bound, is dominated by the energy of the initial data. I use it for the second equation. I arrive at a certain stage, and then I repeat the procedure on subsequent intervals. I use the linearized control to steer the solution of the nonlinear problem, and so on and so forth. And since I get I get estimates which are computable exactly, I can derive this sort of quadratic error, which repeatedly gives me the exponential. This is similar to the Newton algorithm, gives me the exponential decay. So in order to make this strategy work, so I have to explain two things basically. One thing is how do I control the linear system, and the second thing, how do I get this bounds on P. The solution of the linear system is obtained by the moment method. Since the control is one dimensional, the moment method is very efficient here. The moment method consists in developing in Fourier series somehow your so you take the solution, which is represented by the classical formula. If you want it to vanish at time capital T, you take the Fourier coefficient, taking the scalar product with the phi case, and you obtain a countable family of equation that your control has to satisfy by just. So I want to find P that satisfies all this equation. And this is obtained through a bi-orthogonal family to the family of exponentials. And the existence of a bi-orthogonal family is a known fact. And also estimates on the elements of the bi-orthogonal family are such that one can show that the control one computes is in fact in L2 and satisfies the bounds that we required. For the quadratic estimate, there is the second tool, there is nothing extraordinary. You just do energy tricks. And so you take, so you want to show that the error that you have when you replace in the first equation, the control obtained through the second one is quadratic. And so you look at the difference between these two solutions. And you, by energy techniques, you find easily that the difference at time capital T will be quadratic. The norm of the difference will be the square of the norm of the initial condition times some constant that you can master. Okay, so this is once you have treated the case of zero first eigenvalue, the general case is treated by translation, translating the operator by NL1 fact, by lambda one factor. There is nothing So I said that the result can be split, in fact, and generalized. In the first place, you may want to control not just to the first eigenvector, to the ground state, but to a general eigensolution. You fix the solution associated with any eigenfunction, phi j, and you may want to control to such a solution. This is possible, and in fact, the whole theory will be split in an abstract sort of result, and then in the verification of the assumptions. You give this definition. You say that the pair is general controllable in time t, if you can find a control steering the initial if for any initial condition there is a control such that the solution of this equation, when here I have b by j, j is any index between one and infinity, is zero. Once you have general controllability, you can prove that if your linear system is general controllable, then the nonlinear system is stabilizable to the eigenfunction phi j. And then you have to give a result to ensure that the linear system is general controllable. And in that case, you can, a sufficient condition are the two assumption that we saw before, gap condition and spreading condition. So this is the theory. Once you have for the linear part a general controllable pair, then the nonlinear system is super exponentially stabilizable to this function. And then your two assumptions, which have to be adapted to the general case, so you have to subtract this lambda one in the gap condition and replace phi one by phi j in the spreading assumption. If the gap condition and spreading assumption are satisfied, the pair AB is general controllable. And then, of these two assumptions, the gap condition, this one, as is well known, restricts applicability to one-dimensional in space operators in general. It's satisfied by many one-dimensional operators and by very few multidimensional operators. And this is normal. I mean, indeed, you are acting with a scalar function. You cannot hope to control and steer a system in many variables. The second condition, the spreading condition, of course, is related to the technique, but it is somehow necessary if you want to control the linear part. There is no way you can control this linear part if you don't have the spreading condition satisfied. And then if you want to relax this part of the assumption, you have to find the different ways to deal with your bi-orthogonal family. Now, let me skip this. Let me move briefly to the exact controllability results one can pull out of this stabilizability theorem. And the exact controllability result is of this form. Again, you suppose the gap condition. I go back to controllability to the ground state, but you could do the same for general eigenfunctions. You suppose again the gap condition, and you reinforce the spreading condition by requiring a lower bound on the scalar product, right? So, no more just the fact that this is different from zero, but the fact that this is bounded below by some power, the inverse of some power of the eigenvalues. I have separated phi one from the others because I want to allow the first one to be zero, for example. So the first eigenvalue to be zero. So in this case, you can prove a local exact controllability result to the solution starting from the run state. And the same thing is true and can be generalized to any eigensolution, any solution associated with eigenfunctions. Okay. The idea of the proof is simple, but the implementation of the idea is not simple, it's quite technical. So let's stick to the idea only, which is to, well, perform the stabilization procedure on intervals shrinking in such a way that the series converges. Now, this shrinking speed cannot be taken in an arbitrary way. If you take, for example, dyadic splittings, that wouldn't work. But but if you take other kinds of splittings, like this one, you split the intervals in the sum of 1 over j squared times the length of the interval, then this is efficient. Now, I will skip the details because of time reasons. And we have also obtained some quasi-global results, which I will describe just by pictures, not by statement. One quasi-global result is you have your eigenfunctions function phi 1. You can show that there exists a sort of strip about phi 1 that can be exactly controlled to the evolution of the ground state. So there is a neighborhood of phi 1 such that for each r, all the elements which are, well, r1 close to phi 1 and r and with orthogonal components less than uppercase r, they can be steered to the evolution. And another global result, which again I will not give in details, but with the picture, is that you can control essentially the whole space except for the complement of phi 1 for this hyperplane, not to the evolution exactly, but to the function phi 1, which is the evolution times this Fourier coefficient. Okay. So these are the abstract results, and I will spend this last 5 minutes. 5 minutes. For some. Okay. One thing is this strategy can be extended to unbounded operators P, provided they are dominated by the square root of A, essentially under the same assumption, gap and spreading. And this is useful to treat the Fokker-Planck equation. Let me give you 3 examples. One is the heat equation with Dirichlet boundary condition in one space dimension, where I seek to control the evolution through this function P. Right, mu is a given function, so I want to somehow find mu, those functions mu, such that for each u naught I can find a p, well, stabilizing the system or controlling exactly to the eigen solution. So you can rewrite it into an abstract form as usual by taking the second derivative with Dirichlet boundary condition, and for B, the multiplication operator time by the function mu. Here the eigenfunction can be computed explicitly and the gap condition is easy to check. The spreading assumption is obtained, well, you have to integrate by parts. And then you find that if your B, then your function mu in particular, satisfies this property. And if you have this condition at the endpoints, then the assumption, the spreading assumption for the exact controllability result is satisfied. Now the question becomes, what are the function mu that have this property? Well, we can give examples. For example, we already know that the function, a constant function, would not work. But if we take x squared, then that's the job. And in fact, there are many functions that can be used for this purpose. And this will be the subject of the talk by Cristina tomorrow. Okay, so the heat equation can be treated, stabilized, or exactly controlled by a scalar input control here, provided I have fixed this function mu x squared, or the other function Cristina will discuss, will show to you. Another example concerns the similar problem, but in the degenerate case. So x to the alpha with alpha between 0 and 2. In this case, the strategy is completely analogous, but you have to change the spaces, moving to weighted spaces. And this is as is typical for the degenerate problem. And in this case, the eigenvectors and eigenfunctions are also computable, but they require the use of Bessel functions. The gap condition is not so easy as in the previous case to check, but it's true. And then again, the problem becomes finding functions mu that ensure the spreading property. And an example here is this function here, 2 to the 2 minus alpha, that does the job. And last, let me speak about the Fokker-Planck equation in 1D. Again, I try to control it by the P coefficient, but I also have to find the functions mu that ensure the spreading property. So I transform it into an abstract problem. Again, very easy. It's very easy to compute the eigenfunction and eigenvectors, and to check the fact that B is dominated by the square root of A. And in this case, a function mu that ensures the spreading property is any power of X, any monomial. And therefore, for the Fokker-Planck equation, I can control exactly to the first eigensolution, or in fact to any eigensolution, locally, the system, provided the coefficient is as this form. And for any initial condition, I can find a scalar control. So there are other results and extensions of this approach, allowing for relaxation of the gap condition and of the estimate of the control cost that is used here. But I think this, my time is over, so I stop here, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Carnassa, for your nice presentation. I would ask if there are questions, there are comments, or small remarks. Maybe one, two questions.
So, Enrico, on the negative side, could you say something? For instance, if the gap is not fulfilled, these results cannot be true, or something like this?
This approach breaks down if the gap is not fulfilled, because the problem is the construction of the bi-orthogonal family. Certainly, if the spreading assumption is not fulfilled, the linear problem is not exactly controllable. Let me go back to the. Here. So the gap condition is certainly related to the technique, and also to the fact that we are taking a scalar function, because as you remember, when it is, let me go back to the here, right? Well, it's related to the controllability of this linearized part. Here there is not, there are not many way out. If you want V, a capital T to vanish, you have all to have all these equations satisfied. This is due to the fact that P is just time dependent. If there were, if there was a dependence on space, it would be a completely different job. You couldn't argue this way. But if P only depends on time, then you have to have all these assumptions satisfied. And this sort of drags you directly to the use of bi-orthogonal families. Indeed, as I said, even the other assumption, if it is not satisfied, the spreading condition, then, so if the scalar product vanishes in some direction, if B phi j times phi k is zero in some direction, then the corresponding problem cannot be non-controllable, because again, you take the scalar product of your solution, and for each component you have to have an equality. So you have an equality for the Fourier coefficient here, and if this scalar product vanishes, it turns out you can control only initial conditions which are orthogonal to the corresponding eigenfunction. So in order to relax gap and spreading, one has to introduce, in my opinion, dependence on control of space also, and then you can move further in dimension.
Okay, there are two questions, one by Alessio Porretta and another by Morgan Morasse. Please, Alessio.
Yes, the last comment of Pier Marco is possibly related a bit to my comment or question. Because at least in the first model that you have written with this linear problem with multiplicative, say, function B of U, it reminds of some results we had with Enrique through the off-call transform for, say, the viscous Hamilton-Jacobi. But there are two main differences, and this is the spirit of my question. So we considered somehow compactly supported functions mu, which, if I am not wrong, they are not seem not to be included in this kind of approach. And of course, we also considered controls which depend on space and time. And there were phenomena like weight in time for the controllability. So the kind of comment and question at the same time is, if you take your function mu in your, say, last examples, for example, in the local bilinear case, if you take a function mu which is compactly supported, can you do something, or you have to go with controls which are space dependent, and this is somehow obliged? And if you have considered or thought to this kind of question. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we did not explore the problem of finding the most general function mu that allow to have, for example, the spreading property, right? Mm. The result was essentially abstract. So we just found examples to show that it is a non-empty result, that you have functions, yes, coefficients satisfying the spreading property. That's what I was involved with. And also, I think the work by Fatia and Cristina providing more functions, new, satisfying this property, does not really allow for compactly supported functions. But that's, of course, an issue. That's an issue. I mean, from the point of view of this talk, we think about abstract revolution equation, and we consider the operators B with the spreading property. So whatever they are realized by is fine. But of course, that's a very, well, that's an important development if one can find examples of functions with compact support, ensuring this property.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay, and the last question by Morgan Morasse.
Thank you. Thank you, Gianmarco, for the talk. Maybe I missed something on your gap condition. Because
please, Morgan.
Yeah, you do not hear me very well, don't you? You don't hear me?
Please, Morgan, we don't.
Do you hear me, Giuseppe? No?
It's okay, it's okay. Me lo dice per telefono.
Can't hear you, Morgan. We do hear you. A bit mind, but we can hear you. So please go ahead.
Okay, so my question was, sometimes your gap condition is on the square root of the eigenvalue, and sometimes it's on the square root of the eigenvalue minus lambda one. So what is the difference between the...
I cannot hear you. Vabbè,
we are very sorry, but there are some problems with the audio in the room. Then maybe we start with the next speaker, Professor Masahiro Yamamoto from the University of Tokyo. Professor Masahiro Yamamoto is well known to us, is a really expert of inverse problems, Kalman estimate for evolution equation. Then let's start with introduce him for the talk. Thank you for to accept in this occasion.
Please let me share the screen. I cannot do.
Okay, can you share your screen?
No, I'm not permitted.
Okay, you can try now.
Yeah. No, okay. Yeah. Okay, then I think just a moment. Just hold it somehow. Then, sorry, I need to
okay, you can start. Oh.
We don't hear this, the speaker. Tell him to unmute, please.
There is a problem by the audio.
Yeah, I think the problem is that Masahiro didn't open his micro. That's a serious problem.
Can you open your microphone? Now it is out.
I'm very sorry. Now I speak fine, yeah?
Yeah, now it's good. Thank you.
Sorry. Okay, then. Okay, then. I'm Dr. The Joint Work with Professor Pierre Marco Falarosa and Giorgio Tecoloridia. Sorry, I will repeat a little bit from before. Okay, then. Our target is very simple transport equation. Like that, vector field dependent on x and t, and the sum.
Now it is good. We can start. Sorry.
We can start. Okay. Then that is our main target equation. We will consider only this kind of equation, and we will consider this equation in a cylindrical domain. Omega is a spatial domain. Times zero and capital T, time interval. Then where is the bounded smooth domain? Then U is our vector, and T has some smoothness. And let us fix gamma is a sub bounder. Then in principle, we consider like, okay, many voices. And the two problems we are considering, namely, so-called observability. Name determination of initial value by boundary.
So sorry, you can stop please a moment since the in the room there is some problem with the audio. Okay. I don't know if also in the other for the other participants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is a lot of echo, Giuseppe.
Yeah.
Echo. Mm-hmm. I have switched off other things in the neighborhood of the room. Now, to me, somebody is always interesting. Or some like a parallel section. I hope okay. Is it okay?
Sorry, there is a problem with the YouTube direct and the connection is really bad now. We can ask to the staff, but we need some minutes.
Yeah, but usually somebody forgets to switch off the microphone. Then something happens.